Of all great musical compositions, Der Ring des Nibelungen is by far the largest. A consecutive performance of its four separate parts would last for some 15 hours. To confer unity on this vast scheme, Wagner built his score out of a number of recurrent themes, each one associated with some element in the drama and developed in conjunction with that element throughout the work. These themes, or leading motives as they have come to be called, are not mere identification tags. Nor is the score a simple patchwork made up by introducing each motive at the appropriate point in the stage action. Wagner's own description of his themes was melodic moments of feeling, and writing about his intentions beforehand, he said, "These melodic moments will be made by the orchestra into a kind of emotional guide throughout the labyrinthine structure of the drama." Wagner's motives have, in reality, a fundamentally psychological significance, and his score is a continuous symphonic development of them, reflecting the continuous psychological development of the stage action. In consequence, a comprehensive analysis of The Ring would be an enormous task. It would involve clarifying the psychological implications of all the motives and tracing their changing significance throughout the whole of their long and complex development. Nevertheless, understanding and enjoyment of the work can be greatly helped by simply establishing the identity of all the really important motives and indicating what immediate dramatic symbols they stand for, which is all that this introduction is intended to do. The motives are associated with four different types of dramatic symbol: characters, objects, events, and emotions. An example of a motive representing a character is the stern fanfare which introduces Hunding in Act I of Die Walküre. An example of a motive representing an object is the genial theme associated with Friar's golden apples. This is introduced in scene 2 of Das Rheingold. It's sung by Fafner as he explains the value of the apples to Fasolt. An example of a motive representing an event is the brief, agitated figure on the woodwind, which follows Alberic's threat of violence against the Rhine maidens in scene 1 of Rheingold. An example of a motive representing an emotion is the furious, repeated figure on the orchestra, which portrays Siegfried's anger during Act 1 of Siegfried. These examples are only four of the almost innumerable motives in The Ring. But at the heart of this diversity, there's a simple unity. Practically all the motives arise from a few basic motives. Each of these basic motives represents one of the central symbols of the drama, and it generates a number of other motives by a process of transformation to represent various aspects of the central symbol concerned. And so we can thread our way through the jungle of motives in The Ring by grouping them into their different families. We can start from each basic motive in turn and trace the family of motives it generates throughout The Ring before continuing with the next basic motive. The fundamental symbol in The Ring is the world of nature, from which everything arises and to which everything returns. And Wagner's basic motive for this ultimate source of existence is that fundamental element in music, the major chord. This chord, spread out melodically as a rising major arpeggio by the horns, forms the mysterious nature motive which opens the whole work. This is the original form of the nature motive. It soon undergoes a simple melodic transformation into a peacefully undulating string theme. And the result is what may be called the definitive form of the nature motive, since this is the form in which it will recur throughout the whole work. The next transformation is that this definitive form of the nature motive simply begins to move at twice the speed. And in so doing, it becomes a new motive, the surging motive of the River Rhine. tracing further the family of motives generated by the basic nature motive, we must pass on now to scene 4 of the Rheingold for the next transformation. Here, the nature motive, by turning from major to minor, and from a flowing 6-8 to a slow 4-4 time, becomes the dark motive of Erda, the earth goddess. So far, the transformations of the nature motive have been simple ones, but the next is more radical. The motive turns upside down, implying its own opposite. When Erda begins to warn Wotan of the end in store for the gods, the orchestra accompanies her with her own motive, itself a simple transformation of the nature motive as we have heard. But as she comes to the point, the orchestra changes her rising motive into a falling one. The motive of life and growth becomes the motive of decay and death. Here's the whole passage. The orchestra has two statements of Erda's rising motive, followed by its inversion, the falling motive of the twilight of the gods. The strings accompany Erda's voice very softly here, only hinting at the god's mortality. We can hear what happens more clearly if we have the accompaniment played by the orchestra alone. First, the rising Erda motive, and then, immediately, its inversion, the falling motive of the twilight of the gods. This mysterious, falling, fading motive, like so many of the others, recurs at many points in the ring. Naturally, it permeates the final part of the work, the Twilight of the Gods, or Götterdämmerung. And inevitably, it introduces the final scene, when Brynhilde steps forward to perform the decisive actions that bring about the end of the gods. Returning now to the nature motive and its further transformations, after Erda and her warning in Rheingold, we have to wait until Act I of Siegfried for the next transformation, another simple one. This occurs when Wotan speaks to Mimer of the all-powerful spear that he cut from the world's great ash tree, the tree of life, guarded by Erda's daughters, the Norns. The orchestra accompanies his words with a new rhythmic variant of the nature motive in the minor, and in 3-4 time. Here first, as a reminder, is the nature motive again. And here's the swaying motive of the world ash tree, as it's introduced to accompany Wotan in Act I of Siegfried. Listen to the orchestra. Auf meine Äxte feilte Maske, schob es ich eine Kraft, und dir schwamm. This world ash motive, which has a close kinship with Erda's motive, recurs in the Twilight of the Gods, in conjunction with Wotan's cutting down of the Tree of Life to provide fuel to burn Valhalla. It permeates the scene of the Norns, Erda's daughters, who are bewildered by this fatal act of Wotan's. After the introduction of this world ash motive in Act I of Siegfried, the next transformation of the nature motive occurs in the second act, where Siegfried is in the forest. Wagner takes a very slow, dark, minor version of it, akin to Erler's motive, and he superimposes on this a slowly oscillating string figuration. The result is what may be called the embryonic version of the motive of the forest murmurs. This embryonic version of the forest murmurs motive soon begins developing the oscillating figure freely, without regard to the original nature motive basis. Out of this development, by a process of increasing the speed of the oscillation in 6/8 time, Wagner eventually evolves the definitive, shimmering, major form of the forest murmurs motive, the one that is to be used entirely from here onwards. A number of further motives in the nature family are evolved not from the definitive form of the nature motive, with which we've been concerned so far, but from its original form. The rising major arpeggio on the horns which opens the ring and with which we started. These further motives are free transformations of the original nature motive in that they themselves are forms of the rising major arpeggio. First, a reminder of the original nature motive. The first free transformation of this original nature motive is the important motive of the gold, which is introduced by the horns in scene 1 of Rheingold. The next free transformation of the original nature motive is the bold motive of Donner. He himself sings this as he calls up the storm in scene 4 of Rheingold, and he's echoed by the horns. Transformation of the original nature motive is the rising and falling arpeggio of the theme representing the rainbow bridge, again in scene 4 of Rheingold, though this is hardly a motive in the strict sense, since it never appears again. Further transformation of the original nature motive is the heroic trumpet motive of the sword, which is also introduced in scene 4 of Rheingold. This major arpeggio is almost identical in shape with the arpeggio of the original nature motive, as we can hear clearly by comparing them in the same key. Here's the original nature motive as it recurs for the only time, near the beginning of Act 3 of The Twilight of the Gods. And here's the motive of the sword as it recurs in Act 3 of Siegfried, when Siegfried uses the sword to cut away the steel breastplate from the sleeping Brunhilde. This completes the family of motives evolved from the nature motive, either from its definitive flowing form or from its original arpeggio form. A second, much smaller family is closely associated with this, the pentatonic family of the voices of nature. The first vocal utterance in the ring is a voice of nature, that of the first Rhine maiden, Voglinda, and her falling and rising pentatonic theme is the motive which is to be associated with the Rhine maidens. This Rhine maiden's motive is slightly transformed and speeded up to produce the motive of the woodbird in Act II of Siegfried. The woodbird is evidently first cousin to the Rhine maidens. Like the Rhine maidens, isn't represented by a single motive, but by several other figures as well, each having the character of a bird call. The most important of these is a phrase which is particularly associated with the woodbird's message to Siegfried about the sleeping Brünnhilde. One other motive belongs to this small family, that of the sleeping Brünnhilde in Act III of Walküre. Brünnhilde, in her magic sleep, may not be a voice of nature, but she's a latent, inspiring force of nature. And this motive of the sleeping Brünnhilde is a rhythmic variant of the opening five notes of the motives of the Rhine maidens and the woodbird. Here's a reminder of the beginning of the Rhine maidens' motive. And here's the rhythmic variant of the first five notes of that motive, which is the motive of the sleeping Brünnhilde. So much for nature. Standing out against this background of nature are the human actions that constitute the drama, and the intentions behind the various types of action are represented on the stage by several central symbols, Alberic's ring, Wotan's spear, Siegfried's sword, and so on. But prior to all these is the gold from which Alberic makes the ring that sets the whole drama in motion. In itself, it's merely a symbol of mysterious potentialities lying dormant in nature. And as we've heard, its motive belongs to the family of the nature motive. But the various effects of the realization of the potentialities of the gold are represented by a different family of motives. And the basic motive here, which generates the rest, is the salient musical idea of the joyful major key trio sung by the Rhine maidens in Scene 1 of Rheingold, the song in which they celebrate the glory of the gold in its natural setting. This is their cry of Rheingold, Rheingold, higher, 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 higher. Before we trace the many transformations of this motive of the Rhine maiden's joy in the gold, we should notice that it recurs several times in something like this original form. Near the end of Rheingold, it's harmonically modified and melodically developed to form the Rhine maidens' lament for the gold after it has been stolen from them. In this version, the motive recurs again several times. In Act II of Siegfried, for example, it enters on the horns when Siegfried comes out of Fafner's cave, holding the ring and staring at it, wondering what use it can be to him. The horns remind us that it belongs ultimately to the Rhine Maidens. We'll pick up the music at Alberich's final remark and exit. These are simply recurrences of the basic motive of the Rhine Maiden's Joy in the Gold. But the two main segments of the motive are continually transformed into new motives, representing the unhappy results of the realization of the gold's potentialities. We may start with the second of these segments, the cry of Haya Ya Haya. In scene two of Rheingold, Loge sings a dark minor version of this when he describes how the Rhine Maidens complained to him of Alberich's theft of the gold. This already begins to sound a little like the Nibelung's motive in the next scene, and Loge takes the transformation a step further when he repeats the music we've just heard to describe how the Nibelungs are already working on the gold. Loge's embryonic version of the Nibelung motive becomes reality in the orchestral interlude leading to the next scene. Here, the actual motive of the Nibelungs emerges in its definitive form in conjunction with the sound of their hammering. So the Rhine Maiden's joy in the potentiality of the gold has been transformed into the Nibelung's misery in working on the gold, musically as well as dramatically. And the complete basic motive of the Rhine Maiden's joy in the gold is transformed in a similar way to produce another new motive. Again, Loge is the agent of this transformation in scene two of Rheingold. His dark minor version of the Haya Ya Haya segment in his account of the Rhine Maiden's complaint is actually accompanied by the complete motive of the Rhine Maiden's joy in the gold. Here's a reminder of that motive. And here, played by the orchestra alone, is the accompaniment to Loge's account of the complaint of the Rhine Maidens. This minor version of the Rhine Maiden's Joy in the Gold is further slowed down and transformed harmonically to produce the baleful motive of the power of the ring. This enters in scenes 3 and 4 of Rheingold, when Alberich uses the ring to compel the Nibelungs to do his will. Here, the Rhine Maiden's joy in the gold has become Alberich's sadistic pleasure in wielding the all-powerful ring he has made from the gold. One further motive is generated by the basic motive of the Rhine Maiden's joy in the gold, and this too is associated with the unhappy results of the exploitation of the gold. Here, the starting point is the first segment of the motive, the cry of Rheingold, which we'll hear again as a reminder. A dark minor key version of this repeated phrase is associated with the servitude of the Nibelungs in scene 3 of Rheingold. This time, the Rhine Maiden's joy in the potentiality of the gold has become the Nibelung's enslavement to the ring that has been made from the gold. Later, this servitude motive settles down to a more limping form, particularly associated with Mime in Act I of Siegfried. In Götterdämmerung, this servitude motive attaches itself to Hagen, who is himself enslaved to the power of the ring through his desire to get possession of it. Here the motive takes the form of his fierce rallying call to the vassals in Act II of Götterdämmerung. Here we come to the end of the dark family of motives generated by the bright basic motive of the Rhine Maiden's Joy in the Gold. Thing of absolute power which Alberic makes from the gold and puts to such evil use. Alberic's ring is a central symbol of the drama, one of the two central symbols of power, and so it has its own basic motive, which enters in scene one of Rheingold and later generates a whole family of motives. The first embryonic form of the ring motive is the undulating vocal line of the Rhine Maiden Wellgunda in the major key, when she tells Alberic that anyone who can make a ring from the gold will be able to dominate the world. When Alberic reflects on Wellgunda's words, the orchestra repeats her vocal line, and then he sings a tauter version of it in the minor key as he soliloquizes on the possibility of absolute power. This is almost the definitive form of the sinister ring motive, and it soon emerges clearly on clarinets and horns near the end of the orchestral interlude leading to the next scene. The ring motive is a melodic form of a chord, just as the original nature motive is. But whereas the notes of the nature motive make up a major chord, those of the ring motive make up a complex chromatic dissonance in the minor key composed of superimposed thirds. We can hear this sinister harmonic basis of the ring motive by means of a special illustration. The motive played by woodwind with all its notes sustained and kept sounding as a chord. This special illustration helps us to follow the evolution of two important motives belonging to the ring family. First, the motive of scheming, which is mainly associated with the efforts of the Nibelungs to get possession of the ring. This is a kind of groping outline of the ring's harmony. This can be heard from another special illustration. Here's the ring motive played by the cellos, pizzicato, with two bassoons holding the upper third and then falling to the lower third. The bassoon's outline of the ring motive's harmony in that special illustration is the motive of scheming, as it appears definitively at the beginning of Siegfried in association with the plotting of Mime. The other transformation of the ring motive's sinister harmony is the motive of resentment, which is introduced in scene 4 of Rheingold to accompany Alberic's first bitter remarks when he is set free after having been robbed of the ring by Wotan. One further special illustration will make this clear. Here's the ring motive played by the clarinets, with the central three notes of its harmonic basis left sounding at the end as a chord. This diminished triad, which lies at the heart of the ring motif's sinister harmonic basis, is the starting point for the syncopated motive of resentment.
Bin ich nun frei? Wirklich frei? So grüß euch denn meine Freiheit, erster Gruß.
There's one further important effect of the harmonic basis of the ring motif which should be mentioned. This is a case not of generating a new motif, but of generating a new form of an already existing one. The already existing one is that of the power of the ring, associated with Alberich in Rheingold and later. We'll hear it again as a reminder. When this motive attaches itself to Hagen in Götterdämmerung, it takes on a slightly different harmonic form. It now begins with a pungent dissonance. The dissonance which begins this form of the motif is quite simply the full harmonic basis of the ring motif, which our first special illustration will recall to us. As can be heard, this is the exact dissonance which begins the motif of the power of the ring in the form associated with Hagen. The dissonance which begins this form of the motive permeates Götterdämmerung and generates a new motive in Act II. It acts as the starting point of the savage theme known as the motive of murder, which is heard on the orchestra when Alberich incites Hagen to kill Siegfried and get back the ring. So this dissonance permeates Götterdämmerung, creating an atmosphere of progressive dissolution. Wagner made the sinister harmony of the ring motif eat its way more and more into the fabric of the score to reflect the fact that the sinister symbol of the ring itself eats its way more and more into the fabric of the drama. Several other motives representing various aspects of the symbol of the ring are generated by the melody of the ring motif. Three of these stem from its first segment of four descending notes. The most important is the motif associated with the curse which Alberich puts on the ring in scene four of Rheingold, after having been robbed of it by Wotan. Here are the first four descending notes of the ring motif. These four notes are turned upside down to form the menacing motive of the curse. This is introduced vocally by Alberich, but its definitive form is established by the trombones a little later in scene four of Rheingold, immediately after the first effect of the curse, the murder of Fasolt by Fafner. The other two motives generated from the first four notes of the ring motif are those of Hunding's Rites in Walküre and the Vow of Atonement in Götterdämmerung. Hunding, if he is ignorant of the existence of the actual ring, is nevertheless a wielder of the kind of ruthless power it symbolizes. And as for the Vow of Atonement, which forms part of the oath of blood brotherhood sworn by Siegfried and Gunther, the significance of the ring-shaped motive here is one of tragic irony. Through the vow, Siegfried puts himself entirely in the power of Hagen, who uses it as a pretext for murdering him to get possession of the ring. Both these motives are direct transformations of the first four notes of the ring motif, which we'll hear again now. Now here's the stern motive of Hunding's rites, which is introduced vocally by Hunding himself to the words, "Sacred is my hearth, sacred to you be my home."
Heart is mine heart, heart is I dear mine house.
And here's the tragic motive of the vow of atonement, as introduced by Gunther and Siegfried in Act I of Goethe Dämmerung.
Riech mein Bruder, schick den treuen Verbleib.
Two further motives are evolved from the other segment of the ring motif, its last three rising notes. Both enter in scene 3 of Rheingold. The first is that of the hoard of treasure, which appears when Alberich tells Wotan about the hoard and how he will use it to make himself master of the world. The second is that of the dragon, which enters when Alberich transforms himself into a huge serpent, ostensibly to demonstrate the powers of the Tarnhelm, but really to warn Wotan and Loge of his power to guard the ring and the hoard. Both motives are built out of repetitions of the rising third, which ends the ring motif, a note higher each time. And both are given to the tubas to suggest some monstrous evil rising from the depths to engulf the world. Here's the ring motif again as a reminder. The last three notes of the ring motif, repeated over and over by the tubas, generate the motive of the hoard. Here it is as it occurs definitively in the prelude to Siegfried, with the servitude motive repeated above it. The motive of the dragon is a rather freer development of the last three notes of the ring motive, but again it consists of repetitions by the tubas of a phrase revolving round a third, each repetition a note higher than the one before. This dragon motive later takes on a slightly different form on solo tuba to represent Fafner in Act II of Siegfried, when he has turned himself into a dragon to guard the ring and the hoard. This is the last of the dark family of motives generated by the basic power motive of the ring. But there's one separate bright transformation of the ring motive, the first and simplest of all. This emerges soon after the motive has found its definitive form in the orchestral interlude leading from scene 1 of Rheingold to scene 2. Eventually, the newly established ring motive begins to take on a less inimical form. Its sinister harmonic basis becomes much more genial on the horns. Immediately after this, at the very beginning of scene 2, the ring motive changes its harmonic basis a little further to simple major harmonies, and in so doing, it transforms itself into the majestic brass motive to be associated with Wotan's castle, Valhalla. The melodic similarity between the Valhalla motive and the ring motive establishes the near identity of the ultimate aims of Alberic and Wotan, absolute power in each case. And the harmonic contrast between them expresses the much nobler character of Wotan's conception of absolute power compared with Alberic's. But the phrase we have just heard is only the first segment of the Valhalla motive, though the most important one. There are other segments which are also to recur on their own. Two of these soon follow the first one, a repeated falling phrase and a series of alternating chords. The final segment of the Valhalla motive, which is a kind of summing up of its noble character, doesn't enter until the end of Wotan's actual apostrophe to Valhalla itself. It appears on the trumpet at the words, "Noble, splendid fortress." We can hear this final segment of the Valhalla motive more clearly by having the passage played by the orchestra alone. This final segment of the Valhalla motive also occurs frequently on its own. It has a habit of attaching itself to the ends of other motives as a cadence. For example, when Wotan conceives the idea of the sword in scene 4 of Rheingold, it rounds off the trumpet's sword motive with the effect of setting a seal of majesty on the new conception. Although the complete Valhalla motive and its various segments recur throughout the whole work, the motive does not generate a family of motives. This is because Wotan's castle is only a static symbol of his power, not a dynamic symbol of the agency of his power, akin to Alberic's ring. The agency of Wotan's power is his spear. This is the other central power symbol of the drama, and it has its own basic motive, which does generate a whole family of motives. The basic motive associated with the spear has always been labelled the treaty or bargain motive because Wotan's power resides in the treaties sworn on the spear and engraved on it. But these treaties, which are actually the laws whereby Wotan governs the world, are only maintained by his will, and this is what the power of the spear represents. Wotan's spear is the symbol of his will towards controlled, lawful world domination, just as Alberic's ring is the symbol of his will towards uncontrolled, unlawful world domination. And so the basic power motive associated with the spear should take the name of the symbol itself, just as the basic power motive associated with the ring is called the ring motive. The spear motive, which is a stern descending minor scale, first appears in scene 2 of Rheingold. It enters quietly in the bass when Fricka reminds Wotan that he will have to fulfill his contract with the giants and give them the promised payment for building Valhalla, the goddess Freya. Later in the same scene, when Donner lifts his hammer to crush the giants, Wotan stretches out his spear and imposes the law by the main force of his will. And here the definitive form of the spear motive, beginning on a strong beat, enters powerfully on the trombones. Before considering the family of motives generated by this main spear motive, we should notice that it has another segment, concerned specifically with the irrevocable character of the treatise sworn on the spear. This is introduced vocally by Fasolt when he warns Wotan that he must keep faith. The first new motive generated by the descending scale of the main spear motive is a subsidiary one which represents Wotan's actual contract with the giants. This is the real treaty motive. Fasolt introduces it vocally, echoed by the cellos and basses, when he warns Wotan to fulfill the contract.
Weißt du nicht, offen, ehrlich und frei, Verträgen zu fahren?
A more important transformation of the spear motive follows immediately. This is the embryonic form of the majestic motive of the power of the gods, which should perhaps be called the power of Wotan. When Fasolt goes on to warn Wotan that his whole power resides in the laws engraved on the spear, the spear motive enters in the bass below a series of pulsating chords. This is the embryonic form of the motive of the power of the gods.
Was du bist, bist du nur durch Verträge, gelungen ist, wohl bedacht deine Macht.
An intermediate form of this motive enters on the orchestra in Act I of Siegfried, when Wotan tells Mimer how he rules the world with the spear which he cut from the world ash tree. This time, underneath the pulsating chords, the descending scale of the spear motive alternates with its inversion, a rising scale. In Götterdämmerung, the rising scale detaches itself from the descending one to become the definitive form of the motive of the power of the gods. This enters during the Norns scene in the prelude, but it rises to its full strength in the final scene of the work when Brynhilde orders the funeral pyre to be built for Siegfried, which will finally bring the power of the gods to an end. Along another, more complex line of transformation, the spear motive continually generates new motives throughout Walküre. These are derived from the opening six-note segment of the spear motive. They are those of the storm and of Siegmund, Wotan's son and unwitting agent, who at the beginning and end of Walküre is running through the storm for his life. In each of these motives, the descending scale motion of the complete spear motive is checked and opposed. After the first descending six-note segment, a rising motion contradicts it. Indeed, throughout Walküre, the repressive authority of Wotan's will is to be continually challenged by the other characters and eventually neutralized. Here, first of all, is another special illustration presenting the first descending six-note segment of the spear motive. Now here's the storm motive. It consists of the first descending six-note segment of the spear motif played swiftly in alternation with its inversion, the same notes rising upwards. Out of the storm motif emerges the very similar motif of Siegmund, who is to rebel against Wotan's authority. This also enters in the bass, and again the first descending segment of the spear motif is checked and contradicted by a rising motion. A little later in Act I of Walküre, Siegmund's falling and rising motif is joined by the rising and falling one of Sieglinde. As the mood grows more tender, the upward motion, contradicting the spear motif's descent, grows stronger. In Act II of Walküre, Wotan's authority is effectively thwarted by Fricka, who argues him into abandoning Siegmund and the plan of which Siegmund is the unwitting agent. The gloomy motive associated with Wotan here is generally known as discouragement, but it might be called the frustration of Wotan's will, since it's a twisted form of the first descending six-note segment of the spear motive. Here's the segment again as a reminder. This segment, freely transformed, generates the motive of Wotan's frustration. The motive begins with a little turn, twisting moodily around the first note. And not only is the descending motion opposed by a rising one, but it's also hindered by being turned round on itself. Incidentally, this motive, like several others, takes on a new form in Götterdämmerung. The tragic happenings in that work are felt to be at least partly the result of Wotan's change of mind after his humiliation by Siegfried. His sense of frustration, which disappears in the opera Siegfried, returns in Götterdämmerung and grows more acute, as we learn from Waltraute. And this is expressed by a new leaping and falling form of the motive of his frustration. We hear it in the orchestra after Waltraute has told Brünnhilde of Wotan's indifference to everything except the idea of restoring the gold to the Rhine maidens. This motif recurs many times in Götterdämmerung, especially in conjunction with Hagen's plotting to destroy Siegfried, since this act will set in motion the series of events that is to lead to the restoration of the gold to the Rhine maidens. Returning now to Act II of Walküre, after Fricka's exit, Wotan rages against her thwarting of his will, and here the motive of his frustration is inverted, moving upwards instead of downwards. Moreover, it moves straight upwards without convolutions, and in doing so, it generates the furious motive of Wotan's revolt, which is thus a free inversion of the whole original spear motive. It always merges into the motive of the curse, as here on its first appearance. In Act III of Walküre, the twisted motive of Wotan's frustration evolves gradually into the motive associated with Brünnhilde's rebellion against him, the motive of the reproach she addresses to him. At the beginning of this scene, we hear the transformation take place. The motive of Wotan's frustration on the bass strings is answered by a free transformation of it on the bass clarinet, in which the descending motion of the original spear motive is now opposed by a wide leap to the upper octave. This bass clarinet phrase is taken up by Brünnhilde as she reproaches Wotan for condemning her disobedience, her attempt to carry out his original plan, which she knew he had countermanded in spite of his deepest wishes. Her reproach motive presents the full descending scale of the spear motive, continually opposed by leaps to the upper octave.